continue singing on the last verse, same 563. So on in the convent, whether rain or snow, the is God is God is all the love. Come to many blessings, angels in the day. Heaven, God will give you to your generous hand. God will bless his name, the one by one. Add your blessings, see what God has done. God, your blessings, name them one by one. God, your many blessings, see what God has done. And God's people say,
good morning. Good to see each and every one of you here this morning. What a good looking crowd, I tell you. You look good from back here, I can tell you that for sure. Amen. Pastor Ashley, would you open us up in prayer, sir?
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that we have the opportunity to be here in your house this morning. Lord, we're humbled that we could serve you, that we can know you in a personal way. We thank you for your love for us and giving your life on Calvary's cross. We thankful that you're a merciful God, Lord, that your mercies are new every morning. We just ask now this morning that everything that we do be a sweet smelling savor unto you. Lord, I pray if there's anyone here that's not saved, Lord, that they recognize your love for them and realize their need of a savior, that they have sin in their life that needs to be forgiven, and that you are the only one who can forgive that sin. You paid the ultimate price on Calvary's cross. And Lord, we just thank you for our pastor, filling him with your spirit. Use him in a mighty way. May your word be an enrichment to our soul and hearts this morning. And may you be glorified in all that we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen and amen. Let's all be seated. Again, so great to see each and every one of you out. We're also thankful for anyone who might be visiting for the first time. We sure do appreciate having you with us. I wonder, do we have any introductions? Any introductions? Pastor Ashley? Yes, give us a hand wave. Amen. Amen. What a blessing. What a blessing. Any other introductions? Any others?
I do, Pastor.
Mrs. Miller?
I kind of do. I met, and I don't see them anywhere. There's a couple, they brought a friend this morning, and I already forgot her name. But then we also have behind Sheila and Henry, Cindy. She's been with us last year, but this is her first time this year.
So. Amen.
All right. Amen. I'm especially looking forward to meeting, I already forgot her name. Amen. Okay, anybody else? Anybody else?
Pastor.
Yes.
It's not the first time, but I have my father-in-law, and my mother-in-law, and my niece, Taylor, visiting.
Yes, right back there. Amen. Yeah. It's good somebody in the Ashley family remembered them. Amen. Good job, Pastor Ashley. Amen. Just kidding.
Justin.
All right. Do I have another hand up? Justin Miller. Okay, amen. Is anybody else trying to get off the hook? It's not Anita Miller's first time here, but I just wanted to know. Amen. Any others? Let's share a few quick announcements and continue with the service. And this one here, I know you're going to pay attention to. Today we have our church family and friends Thanksgiving dinner, and that's at 4 p.m. So here's the plan. I get to preach over because you're not going to go to lunch. You're going to be wanting to come hungry at 4 o'clock, amen? And so make up your mind. Just plan to be here for sure. Always a good time of, I can tell you for sure, food and fellowship. You want to be here for this special meal. And all of our newcomers, anybody who's new with us, you're our special guest for this time also. And if you're bringing food, you want to get the food here by 3:30, all right? And always a special time. Please notice, no Awana. We will not have Awana this Wednesday due to the Thanksgiving holiday. We will resume the following Wednesday. Our Awana store is set for December 14th. If you would like to help supply items or help with financial donations, please see Commander Ralph Garza. Okay? And may I also say that we will have a regular church Wednesday night service right here for sure. And I just think a really wonderful way to pray in your Thanksgiving day would be here to come for our time of preaching and our praying time on Wednesdays. We're still going to make sure that we do that. Amen? And please notice, Mrs. Miller wants to share regarding church family photo.
I want to thank everyone for the last 2 days who was here. I know that some of you had to wait an excessive amount of time, but we got it all done. Some of you weren't able to make it. I know who you are, and I know where you live. But next Sunday, I'm going to ask for a little more patience, because we're going to do the group picture. And if you haven't seen the one in the foyer, it's a big group. We're all standing out in front of the church. It takes a little while to get us all organized and out there. So eat a good breakfast so you're not hungry and grouchy, okay? We're all going to get out there. We're going to line up. We're going to get a good picture. And those of you who were not able, for whatever reason, to get your picture the last 2 days for the church directory, Matt, thank you. Your wife said yes, that you guys could also take some pictures for us of families next Sunday. So we'll try to get it all done. We've got to get all this in so we can get our directories back. But I appreciate your patience, your help, and just your smiles, because it always makes everything better. Thank you.
Let me just say, if you don't get your picture taken, we will make an avatar of you that you will not be happy about. So I would encourage you to get your picture taken. Amen? Amen. All right, let's continue with the service.
Please turn to hymn 557. In thanksgiving, let us praise him. 557.
Songs
Let's all stand one more time, please, as we sing hymn 561. 561. We gather together, 561.
Sir. Heavenly Father, we do thank you, Father, for today and, Father, for all your blessings, Lord. And, Lord, we ask for your blessings upon our services this morning, upon our pastor, upon the message that he has for us. We ask for your blessings in everything that is said and done, Father. And as we pick up this offering, Father, we ask for your blessing also, Father. We pray that you'd bless it, Father, and that in all things you might have and get the glory from.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
That's wonderful, really. Let's dismiss our beautiful kids now, our children. Jesus loves me, this I know.
Blessing. Considering the holiday, there's a 99.99% chance, are you ready, that I'm probably going to preach on Thanksgiving. How many believe that that might be the case? The real truth is, every message is a Thanksgiving message, isn't it? It really is. Because Jesus is all about giving thanks. Jesus Christ, if you've trusted him as your Savior, you've got to be thankful 24/7. There's no doubt about that. I'm thankful for this holiday, for us to take the time in a very special way to place a special emphasis on Thanksgiving. But the real truth is, we ought to be thankful when being thankful isn't even in style. Amen? That's really the truth. That's really the truth. And one of those great psalms you'll find, Psalm 116, truly is a psalm of Thanksgiving. Would you turn there with me, please? Psalm 116. And again, we're going to do what we like to do around here, break all the rules, read more scripture than we're supposed to as far as the world's concerned. And we'll just leave that in the Lord's hands for sure. Preachers, know this. You don't make a mistake when you read the Word of God. The very best thing that'll take place today is the reading of God's Word. No doubt about that. Please notice with me these first 8 verses. In Psalm 116. Psalm 116. How about the way it begins? I love the Lord. Amen. Amen. Capital in my Bible, capital L-O-V-E, capital L-O-R-D. I love the Lord because he hath heard my voice and my supplications, because he hath inclined his ear unto me. Therefore, will I call upon him as long as I live. The sorrows of death compass me, and the pains of hell get hold upon me. I found trouble and sorrow. Then called I upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I beseech thee, deliver my soul. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Yea, our God is merciful. The Lord preserveth the simple. Now that's one of my verses right there, I can guarantee you. The Lord preserveth the simple. I was brought low, and he helped me. Return unto thy rest, O my soul, for the Lord hath dealt bountifully with thee. And let's notice, and we'll stop right here, but we'll continue in just a little bit. For thou hast delivered my soul from death, mine eyes from tears, and my feet from falling. Oh Lord, already, even before we begin to preach, because we have read and meditated upon your word, you're already, Holy Spirit of God, moving through us, undertaking to teach us. Teach us, Lord, to be thankful today. It's so easy to fall into the trap of only considering material reasons for us to be thankful. We will watch a lot of television that'll remind us of that, every ad, every commercial. But we have way more to be thankful for than just the material things of life, although we should be thankful for everything. Help us, Lord, help us even today to make this special time of year an extra special time of teaching and considering how great you are and how much you love us. I would pray for the spiritual heads of the home today. Would you make this week, this special time special for your children and your extended family? Maybe some of us have family that are visiting, friends that we'll be getting together with. Let them know about the Jesus that you're thankful for. Would you do that? Would you let the Lord just work through you this week in a special way? And Lord, begin with this preacher and speak to each and every one of us today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Notice again Psalm 116, these first two verses again. I can just read this with a smile on my face all day long. I love the Lord because he hath heard my voice and my supplications, because he hath inclined his ear unto me. Therefore will I call upon him as long as I live. I just got to tell you, that's good. That's good. One of the greatest Christian virtues is thanksgiving. Our grateful expression of thanks to God as we acknowledge him as the source of all blessings. We're talking about blessings bestowed in grace. Notice James chapter 1 verse 17, wonderful verse. James 1:17, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no, I love this, in whom is no variableness. In a world like the world we live in, that matters even more. Neither shadow of turning. That's the Lord that you love, that we trust. Today we consider Psalm 116. Psalm 116 praises God for the personal triumphs he has brought to pass. When you read the Psalms, consider that these Psalms always have a backstory. They weren't just simply songs that were sung to win a Dove Award or a Grammy. Real people with real lives penned these words. And in the canon of Scripture that we hold in our hand, the Holy Spirit spoke through them. The author of this psalm had suffered a severe illness and had been in a very, let me just put it this way, the very jaws of death. Maybe for some of us, even here this morning, we can relate to that. If you've ever come close to death and the Lord has preserved you and brought you out of that, you know what thankfulness is all about, don't you? If you've ever had a loved one that was ill beyond the point where any human intervention could make a difference, and the Lord brought them through that, you know what thankfulness is all about, don't you? This psalm is a glorious shout of thanksgiving because of deliverance from the illness that was already ushering him into the realm of the dead. Now, I got to tell you, for the psalmist, especially during this period, in Judaism, they basically didn't think a lot about the afterlife. It was a new understanding that this world is not to be your home, that you're just passing through. As a born-again Christian, we know and we're thankful that absent from the body, present with the Lord. Amen? And so this new concept to them was important that they understand that not only have I saved you to the uttermost, if you place your trust in me, but I am also the God that can make a difference even in your life here and now. But you know, even for you and I, the real truth is, if you know Christ as your Savior, you know where you're going to spend eternity. And can I get an amen?
Amen.
But I'll tell you what, I want the Lord to leave me here as long as he wants me to be here. That's really the truth. Now, there are times when I feel more like going. But I remember the one fellow who was asked, are you ready for the Lord to come? He had just recently trusted Jesus Christ as his Savior, and he was just kind of quiet, you know. He didn't learn how to say amen and hallelujah yet. And they asked him again, aren't you ready for the Lord to come? He said, well, you know, I'm looking forward to it, but you're not getting a busload going tonight, are you? You know? I mentioned this last night, had the opportunity to preach over at Shining Light Baptist Church. So thankful for Brother Jaime and his group that was over there and was invited to preach. And I got to tell you something. I looked around at what the Lord was doing over there, and I'm here to say we've got a lot to be thankful for, how God is using men and women of God all around us. And the real truth is, I'm thankful for the Lord coming, but the real truth is, as I mentioned last night, he's got you here for a reason, doesn't he? If he were through with you on this side of eternity, he would have scooped you up out of this world and taken you out of here, and so you're here for a reason. And so I got to tell you, first and foremost, let's give him thanks, and let's glorify him. Regarding the psalmist, he declared that because of God's grace, he would keep on praising God. I love that. You say, well, what can I do? How can I be of use? I'll tell you what, if you're a God praiser, you're going to be of use. If you just, you say, well, I'm not the greatest singer in the world. Well, not everybody can sing like me. I just got to tell you. You just got to understand that. I'm really having fun with that. I'm very uncomfortable with speaking publicly. Whatever the issue might be, I'll tell you what you can do. You can praise the Lord for the rest of your life. For the rest of your life. Don't you love that scripture? I got to tell you something. Call upon him as long as I live. And that's saying something when you just get saved. And it's pretty special when a few months go by. But when I look at some of our senior saints who have been demonstrating for us what it means to trust the Lord and to praise him and magnify him for 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, even 60 years, whatever the case may be, they've demonstrated for us, and we better honor this, that they are calling upon the name of the Lord with every breath for their whole life. We don't know how much time we have, do we? We might not even finish today. We would like to get that meal late before we leave. But if in fact the Lord were to take us today, that would be okay. But if he should delay, if he should tarry, let's just call upon him. Let's just trust in him. Let's just love him and thank him for the rest of our life. This is gratitude. I mentioned this before, but I remember hearing a great message at Southland Camp. The preacher preached that you ought to have an attitude of gratitude. And I'll tell you what, that ought to be the attitude of every born-again Christian. Gratitude. Gratitude. The psalmist's love for God and his gratitude to him prompted him to do something for the one that he loved. Have you ever noticed how when it comes to two people who fall in love, you don't have to prompt them to do something about it? They'll be looking for ways to express their love for one another. They'll be talking up each other and looking at each other with those gaga eyes. I'm looking at who I should pick on. No, I won't do that. You know, it starts out cute, and about 40 years it becomes a little bit monotonous, but you know what I mean. The real truth is, when you love, that's what propels your desire to do something about it. And we preachers, I got to be honest with you, we have a tough time sometimes when it seems like we're trying to convince people to love the Lord. Can I just ask you a question? Why in the world would we ever have to do that? Notice just a couple of points, so don't get too nervous. Number one, the psalmist testified to what the Lord had done for him. As we read these first eight verses, please notice the second verse. He hath inclined his ear unto me. He hath inclined his ear unto me. How comforting it is to know that the Lord is interested in us as individuals. That's special. That's what makes this relationship so personal. He is an intensely personal God. That was hard. May I say that was hard for the early Hebrew to understand. I love to read Psalm 23 and meditate on all the personal pronouns. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. You know, we're not alone. I mean, who can read Matthew? I actually preached from this text last night. Matthew chapter 6. Verse 25. Let's notice, Matthew. We know these verses, but let's celebrate together this great scripture. Matthew chapter 6, verse 25. Look at verse 25 with me. Therefore, I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body, what ye shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they? By the way, we worship the Creator, not the creation. Amen? Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit unto a stature? Other than William Ashley, I don't think that can happen. Amen? By the way, he claims to be 6'8". I need to talk to his parents about that and get that straightened out. Maybe when he had a little more hair, that might have been the case, but... Look at verse 28. And why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Therefore, if God so clothed the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or whither, wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. And then notice, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for the morrow, for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. We have a lot to be thankful for, don't we? We need to have an attitude of gratitude. Without appreciating this grateful security that we have in the Lord, maybe we're not as thankful as we should be. I can remember over the years how important it is for us to teach and preach and drive home the fact that when you trust Jesus as your Savior, you're saved to the uttermost. It's not by works of righteousness which you have done, but it's according to his mercy that you're saved. Amen? And when people get a hold of that, I see that they become more adamant in the area of sharing the gospel. Because is there any greater news than that? Can we be more thankful than to be thankful for our salvation? Listen to the comforting testimony of Jesus in that great chapter, John chapter 14. Notice verse 16. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. May I say this? I will come to you. That's the relationship that we have with the Lord today. Please notice, he hath heard my voice and my supplications. Great scripture. He hath heard my voice and my supplications. The Hebrew verb translated heard in verse 1 indicates more than simply to hear. It indicates that God heard and answered. May I say this? God hears and answers. God is always ready to provide. You know, he's looking forward to the next opportunity. Are you ready? To provide. You think sometimes, knock, 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 I don't want to bother you today, Lord, but could I just ask for one more thing? That's not the heart of the Lord. He's looking forward to providing. The words of Jesus in Luke 11, 9 through 11 are truly assuring. We're reading a little bit of Bible today. Is that okay? Ask and it shall be given you, seek and ye shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you, for everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened. If a son shall ask bread of any of you that is a father, will he give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he for a fish give him a serpent? I know the answer. No! The Lord loves you. He's always looking forward to the next opportunity to bless you. Some of us, maybe even in our circles, have, I think, misrepresented the heart of the Lord. God is in the business of being absolutely 100% interested in you. He really is. He offered his grace, we see in verse 5. He inclined the Lord, or rather, he indicated that the Lord is gracious, the Lord is righteous, the Lord is merciful. I want you to think about that the next time you look to the Lord. The Lord is gracious. The Lord is righteous. The Lord is merciful. You say, well, are you sure about that? Some people have an attitude about the Lord that he is so hard and coarse. You know, and some would even try to come to that conclusion with Old Testament passages. I'll show you Old Testament scripture that speaks to the true, wonderful, gracious, righteous, merciful God that we serve. I mean, how grateful we should be this Thanksgiving season. There's no doubt about it. All year long, but in a special way, shouldn't people be able to take advantage, born-again Christians, of this opportunity to really point people to the one we're truly thankful for? I'll tell you, people need to see that we're thankful for the grace of God. You know these verses, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. Amen. For by grace ye are saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is, and this is an important word, the Lord chose this word, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto, what does the scripture say? Good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. May I say this? Let's get a hold of this morning. Our good works are out of gratitude. We're not working our way to heaven. That was settled on the cross. Our works, our good works, we don't go knocking on doors trying to earn points with the Lord. You know, when you've got something as good as you have in the Lord, who in the world wouldn't want to tell somebody about it? Isn't that amazing how we still have conversations about whether or not we ought to share the gospel? Oh, what else do you want to share? I mean, what else is more important? What does this world need? There's a story told of a pastor who had visited a little northern Oklahoma Sunday school. And the lesson was on grace. The teacher asked, what is grace? One man answered, grace is the unmerited favor of God bestowed on us unworthy sinners. Someone else added another thought. Then the teacher looked at the heavy-set old man dressed in overalls and he asked, Bill, what do you say grace is? Bill thought for a moment and scratched his thinning gray hair. Finally, he said, well, I ain't for sure, but I think it means that God provides all the stuff. God provides all the stuff. Notice with me, he delivered him. The psalmist understood deliverance in verses 6 through 8. Let's look at these verses again. You know, as we read through these, I always think about this when we're reading scripture. May I say, if you need help with this, ask the Holy Spirit to always help you to listen extra special carefully when we're reading the Word of God. Look at these verses again. Psalm 116, look at this sixth verse. The Lord preserveth the simple. I was brought low, and he helped me. Return unto thy rest, O my soul, for the Lord hath dealt bountifully with me. For thou hast delivered my soul from death, mine eyes from tears, and my feet from falling. I mean, what a tremendous tribute to the grace and mercy of God. I got to tell you, we, by example from our Lord, his example, as he demonstrates grace and mercy, we're to be thankful for the grace and mercy that we've received, and people ought to see it in us. I remember one time bringing that point up, and someone had shared, you know, Pastor said something about we're supposed to exercise grace and mercy because we've been shown grace and mercy, like Jesus. And the person responded, well, that's, I'm not Jesus. Can I just say this? We're to desire to be Christ-like, to have the mind of Christ. Thankful people are thankful to others. Those who are thankful for what the Lord has done demonstrate that type of grace and mercy in the lives of others. For thou hast delivered my soul from death, mine eyes from tears, and my feet from falling. That's who the Lord is. That's what the Lord does. The psalmist had a terrible plight. He was helpless, and God delivered him. In this light, how meaningful are the words, those great verses, those great scripture, that great scripture in Isaiah chapter 40. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 28. Hast thou not known, hast thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary. There is no searching of his understanding. He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increaseth strength. How about that? Even the youths, that's Y-O-U-T-H, the youths shall faint and be weary. And the young men shall utterly fall, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. I would say, we who are delivered, we who are born again, we who have so much to be thankful for, ought to be very busy as ambassadors for Christ, demonstrating grace and mercy towards others. And now, only 2 points this morning. Still morning, barely. So, secondly, please notice, the psalmist responds to God's goodness. Oh my, we have such a great God. Let's read some more scripture. Look with me, Psalm 116, look with me at verse 12. Tune in, plug in right now. Are you ready? What shall I render unto the Lord for all his benefits towards me? I will take the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows unto the Lord now and in the presence of his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. O Lord, truly I am thy servant. I am thy servant and the son of thine handmaid, thou hast loosed my bonds. I will offer to thee, how important is this? The sacrifice of thanksgiving, and will call upon the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows unto the Lord now in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of thee, O Jerusalem, praise ye the Lord. I got to tell you, when all has been said and done, no matter what your situation, no matter what your circumstance, no matter where you're at in any station of life, praise ye the Lord. I will take the cup of I will take the cup of salvation. Salvation here includes more than being in an individual or initial experience. It includes salvation in the fullest extent with all its attendant blessings. Today, think of the blessings of your salvation, but also thank God for them. You see, you're thankful for your salvation, aren't you? You're thankful that you're saved, but are you thankful in a continuing way for how that impacts your life today? I've got to tell you, no matter what you see on television, no matter what might be going on, may I just say this? Be thankful for your salvation. I will call upon the name of the Lord. Now, that language for us often speaks of the initial calling on the Lord to be saved. But here, it's a resolution to pray, to continue to pray, to commune with God. For you and I, as born-again Christians, we continue to call. It basically means to pray. I will commune with God. I will call upon the name of the Lord. The psalmist recognized prayer as a valuable ally. You show me someone who's not praying, and I'll show you someone who's not thankful. I'll tell you, you cannot be thankful if you're not spending time with Him. I will walk before the Lord, verse 9. The psalmist testifies that he always will be conscious that God is looking upon his life, knowing every thought, knowing every word, knowing every deed. That's the Lord. Psalm 139 says we can't run from the Lord. We can't hide from the Lord. We can't go anywhere that he's not there. And when we're not walking with him the way we should, we say, oh my. But when we are looking and seeking him, we say, amen. Listen, as I read Psalm 139, I just spent some time in the Psalms this week, and I got to tell you, I had to cut a lot out that I knew we didn't have time for. But my, oh my, Psalm 139, look at these first few verses. O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my downsitting and mine uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off. Thou compassest my path and my lying down and art acquainted with all my ways. Don't you love that? The Lord is acquainted with all your ways. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether. Thou hast beset me behind and before and laid thine hand upon me. In light of these facts, may I say the psalmist wanted his life to be pleasing to the Lord. We're not going to be pleasing to the Lord if we're not thankful. Thankful for our salvation. Thankful for our continuing walk in relationship with the Lord. It makes us desire to be pleasing to him. You know, some of us, even as we got ready for church this morning, did we ask ourselves this question? What can I do to be pleasing to the Lord? How might I might be more pleasing to the Lord today? Wouldn't that make a huge difference when we take our mind off of everybody else and everything else and just say, in my work today, I'm going to be pleasing to the Lord. Before my family today, I want to please the Lord. The word vow, V-O-W-S, your vows. You know, one person was asked, well, I know you just got married. Do you know your vows? And he goes, yeah. A-E-I-O-U and sometimes W and Y. Amen? We are a society now that won't say yes, won't sign up for anything, won't commit. You know, we won't join church. We won't make an outward profession of faith. We won't sign that dotted line. We want somebody else to just please us and do whatever might be fine for us. But hey, wait a minute. It's not right that we should have to ever make a vow. Well, you better read your Bible, my friend. Notice verse 14 and verse 18. I will pay my vows. Did you see what the scripture said? I will pay my vows. Well, we were doing fine, preacher, until you started to go that direction. I don't mind telling people that I'm thankful. But I sure don't want it to cost me anything. In his illness, the psalmist had made a vow to God. He promised to publicly praise the Lord and give him glory for his life. I got to tell you, we must remember that a promise to God is sacred. Has that ever happened? Can you relate to what I'm talking about? Have you ever said, Lord, Lord, if you'll do this, I make this vow. I will be faithful, Lord. I will tell people about you, Lord. I'll answer the call, Lord. I'll just be able to give you praise and glory and shout from the housetops how great you are. The Lord undertakes for us, and we're miraculously touched by him in a special way. And sometimes we forget to even say, thank you, Lord. We just go on and move on and forget that important conversation that we had. Forget what we said to the Lord. The language here, I will pay my vows. So what he did was make a vow, and now it's payment time. Pay up. Talk is cheap. You can say you love me all day long. Show me a couple where they're demonstrating their love for one another, and the phrase I love you means a lot more. I will praise the Lord. Verse 19. The psalmist not only indicated his own praise to the Lord, but encouraged others to praise him. I'll tell you what. When we are able to infect others, compel them to love the Lord, to praise him, we can change an entire mindset, an entire attitude. I've seen churches that were steering in the wrong direction. And then somebody just decided, I'm going to be the light in the corner. I'm going to praise the Lord. And I've seen them reset their course and focus again on what most importantly they do. I will praise the Lord. The psalmist not only indicated his own praise. Yes, you praise the Lord, but encourage others. Encourage others. Can I say this? This Thanksgiving season, let's remember to praise the Lord. Can we do that? Can we understand how great he is? Praise him for his goodness and for his wonderful works. As a matter of fact, we're referred to the children of men. Psalm 107 talks about praising him for his wonderful works to the children of men. I got to tell you, go ahead and turn off that phone. Get as far away from that device as you can. Sometime, get away from the television and get away from all the white noise and spend some time praising the Lord. Let's all stand. Our precious Lord and Heavenly Father, how sweet it is today among brothers and sisters to consider all of your goodness, how you deserve all praise and glory as we meditate on all of your attributes, as we consider how precious it is to know you in a personal way. My heart would break now for even one here this morning who cannot say, "Preacher, I totally understand what you're talking about," because you haven't placed your trust in Jesus Christ. You see, it's very simple, dear one. Recognize that you're a sinner in need of a Savior. The Bible says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not one." Say yes to Jesus Christ. Call upon the name of the Lord, and you will be saved. Turn from sin and turn to Him. He went to the cross and paid for your sins so that you can spend and live for all eternity praising and magnifying Him. But for us today, as born-again Christians, we don't wait until we're on the other side of eternity to praise Him. Speak to hearts, Father, we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen.